Welcome to the Jim Gerard Show, brought to you in part by the pharmacists in green at your neighborhood Hook's Dependable Drugstore. Now, let's join Jim and his special guests.
We're on the farm today of Eiffel Plasterer, and his farm is located right outside of Huntington, Indiana. This is a gentleman who, after 81 years, continues to farm the land. He grew up on this farm. He was born here in a house that's, oh, right behind the barn here. He's a gentleman who taught science for more than 25 years. And recently, you might have seen him on the Tom Snyder Show. He is unique, and he does all kinds of fabulous things with bubbles and lights. And, of course, he farms. Now, since we've gotten to know Mr. Plasterer, we decided that we'd come out and visit. And instead of doing one show, we would do two. We're going to talk to him today and tomorrow, so then he can share his philosophies with us. We're just delighted you let us come.
Yeah, well, I appreciate your coming, and I think it's very nice of you. And it's educational to me, see?
Well, we're the ones who are learning. You are a man of many interests. You've always lived a simple life out here on the farm, and yet you're very sophisticated in what you do and what you create. I know that the media has a way of peeking in on you from time to time. Tom Snyder was here not long ago.
Yeah, well, I went to New York for the Tom Snyder show, yes.
Yeah.
The Tomorrow show.
But he was interested in you.
Oh, yes, very nice. They treated me wonderful. Everything was just grand. But I did not get a chance to visit Tom before the program, like I am you, and I do appreciate this, that I can talk to you directly.
Well, what did you talk about on that show? What did they want the national audience to know about you?
Well, we really didn't have too much time. He asked me how I got started on bubbles. That was the main thing.
Well, tomorrow we're going to demonstrate the bubbles, and Eleanor Ensley, our producer, is going to be encased in a bubble.
Of course, I guess when I was a kid, I liked to show off. I liked to do things, and I always played by myself, see? I didn't have anybody else to play with. I was 7 years the youngest one in the family, and so since I didn't have boys to play with, I played with men. They were men of my own imagination, of course. They were full-sized men, and we'd go out, and when the thrash machine came in the neighborhood, why, I'd go and get a couple of wheels and put a piece of board behind it and push it around. I was a thrasherman then, see?
So now
I had a lot of fun.
So you live out your childhood fantasies by doing it for real now.
Well,
I notice in the back, that's your son Bill there, and he's a good guy, and I know that he lives with you here, and he carries on in your tradition. Making up the lumber is a very important part of what you do.
Sure. Well, I'll tell you, I had a terrific love for machinery. And wheels going around, railroad locomotives and steam engines. I think the greatest thing was the steam engine, and then the thrasher machine itself was a regular, well, I've called it later on a physics lab. It is really a wonderful. And so that was the reason. I'm just crazy about machinery.
Well, you have all kinds of steam equipment here. Some of it's working, some of it isn't. You have a small museum, really.
Well, I think so. Of course, the upshot of that was when I went to college, I changed my major from philosophy to natural philosophy, which is physics, see? I kind of changed my plans a bit.
But you are a philosopher. There's no question.
Well, I've had a lot of fun in life. I think the good Lord's been good to me because I've had such a variety, see? I take it like this. If we are working at something we do not like, we're only having fun part of the time. But if we are working at something we like to do, we're having fun all the time. Not only when we're working to make our money, but when we're spending it, but while we're making it, see?
So you went off to college and obviously taught for 25 years. You could have chosen to do any number of things, but you chose to come back to the farm and stay here.
That's right. I'll tell you, one reason in my own mind why I wanted to study physics, I wanted to teach it, was I felt that if I could have a lab like a good high school has, lab, and I had two of them. I had the physics lab and the chemistry lab, and I could try out ideas there, see? I try to do research as a high school teacher. I actually did research, and research in various things, like in pendulums. And I had quite a affair with pendulums, even had one patented. and made the various designs made by pendulums.
You are truly, sir, a natural student. I know that you taught for years, but you are really a student. You're learning all the time. You're learning today.
So, well, that's the way it was with bubbles. You see, I never blew a bubble in my life until I was 25 years old. Then I was teaching, and I said to the class, at the end of a period, I said, now, if any of you people can tell me how to blow soap bubbles, why, there's very interesting experiments we can do, and I think you'll enjoy them. And so they told me. I humbled myself before the class and said, help me out. I want to know how to blow soap bubbles. And so they told me, but that wasn't very good bubbles, and they weren't as good as the ones I seen in college by the old professor. I knew what bubbles could do, see, although I'd never had any experience with them.
Well, we'll pick up on that, sir.
I set out to improve the solution. That's what I did then.
Well, we're going to demonstrate that on tomorrow's show, and we're going to show just what he does with bubbles. He encases people in bubbles, but that's just part of the story. We want to visit with Mr. Plasterer and focus on what he considers important in life. And to share with us on that basis. Hook's Dependable Drugstore, as you know, is responsible for our show and everything that we do, Mr. Plasterer. And as you know, there are Hook's Dependable Drugstores throughout Indiana and in southern Illinois and in southern Ohio. And they continue just as you for the last 75 years, or now 80 years. They have been in existence in our community, and they continue to grow, and they are modern, and of course they're educated, but they still cling to the old tradition,
yeah.
And that is that they are first and foremost a pharmacy dedicated to everyone's good health, and that's why they're there, and that's why they continue in that tradition. So wherever you travel in the state of Indiana, if you're ever in the Huntington area or in Fort Wayne or in Bern or wherever, you're going to find a Hook's Dependable Drugstore standing by to serve you. Many of them open 24 hours a day. It's part of their commitment and their philosophy. They're good neighbors dedicated to your good health.
Yeah, I'm sure appreciated that.
Sometimes, illness or accidents can make it difficult for us to move about at will.
This is his farm. This is where he was born 81 years ago, and he spent his life here. He taught school for about 25 years. He taught sciences. And indeed, he has entertained a lot of people, too. But he clings to a lifestyle where he's able to do his own thing. You know that phrase, do your own thing. I think that came out of the 60s, but you were focused on that long before that.
Yeah.
You've always done what you wanted to do. You knew what your purpose was in life.
Well, I knew that I wanted to do something worthwhile, and so I started to college with the idea of majoring in philosophy and maybe becoming a minister, but I never felt that I had really a call for it, and it kind of bothered me. And then when I realized how interesting physics could be and how I could teach and have a captive audience always, and I thought that I could maybe, because I was a poor student, I never was a very bright student, I thought that maybe I could understand why students have difficulty.
Well, I understand. Go ahead.
So I decided to be a teacher of physics, and it was this love that I had for machinery that helped me make that choice.
Well, now, at this point in time, 81 years old, and you're in such great health, and you look wonderful, and you're so slim, and you work hard, and you continue to farm your 80 acres. You know what he said about his 80 acres while the commercial was running? He said, it isn't a very big farm, not very good for growing, he said, but great for growing kids. Now, that's part of your philosophy.
I might add, though, that I couldn't do it if I didn't have a wonderful son, Bill.
Bill's wonderful.
Taking over, see? And we think most of the time I'm right. And then my daughter, Alice, likes to come out and work, too. So it's really a family project, see?
Mr. Plasterer, for our television audience today, what wise words would you like to pass on? If you could tell them anything that you've learned in your lifetime that you want to share, what would you tell them?
Well, I see so many people that are happy in their old age, but they seem to be people who have been interested in something. Get interested in something and have a hobby that's worthwhile, something that is interesting. Now, there's a lot of difference between a hobby and a pastime. A pastime, your money's gone quick as you have it. But a hobby, you can sell it after you have your fun with it.
And
if
there's
you
nothing wrong with selling it, is
it? No. So I say be interested in things and have a variety of things that you're interested in. I think too many people like their, well, I would say teachers, where they give their life to teaching and then all at once nothing to do for nothing. And I think that's hard on their health. That's the reason why I wanted to retire early from teaching. So I retired at the ripe old age of 49.
And you've been doing what you want to do ever since.
And the people say, well, when are you going to retire? I said, my gracious, I did that long ago. But I think of retiring as like putting new tires on a car. You retire it.
And just keep going.
Yeah.
Maybe in a little different direction.
Yes.
Well, you're very busy out here. I know you have your own grist mill out here. You make up sorghum. Obviously, we've seen your sawmill, yeah, and your other activities. You're very busy.
Yeah. Well, it keeps us out of mischief. Instead of worrying about problems that we can't control, and there's so much wrong in the world, it'll depress people. And you just got to get your mind on something positive. And I would like to say, like Oral Roberts said, and to me, it was a new idea, and I believe he's right. He said, we should be a part of the solution rather than a part of the problem.
That's well said indeed.
No.
I know that organic food, the choice of food, the way it's grown, the way you select it, this is very important to you. Share some of that with us.
Well, I have a program called Fun Organically, and I found it isn't hardly practical to try to do it all in one night or at one time. I'm going to double up, and so we divide the first half as a show in itself, or that is, if you call it a show, it's really a program, and it's called Fun Organically from the standpoint of the consumer, and the second part is Fun Organically concerning the producer. So you see, we are doing both. We are consuming because we're eating, and we like to select food that's good. That's one reason I have a stone mill. I want good old-fashioned cornmeal and good whole wheat flour.
But for those of us who can't do that, what tips do you have for those of us who have to go to the store and pick out things?
Well, then, I claim that anybody can have fun organically if they just get wise to it. Pick out good, healthy foods. For instance, if it's peanut butter, get the old-fashioned kind. And that isn't doped up with hydrogenated fats and oils. And, of course, it'll settle, see? But that's all right. It's good for you, see? And so you can get a lot of good food out of a supermarket, but you can get some awful poor food.
And so read the labels, that's one thing.
Well, get wise to it as much as you can. And as much as you get interested in good health, why, you'll just be that much healthier, I figure.
Well, you look marvelous. We're going to continue after this word from Hooks and our other good friends. Don't go away. We're visiting on the farm today of Eiffel Plasterer, a gentleman who, after 81 years, continues to farm the land on which he was born. He's a philosopher, he's a teacher, and we're just delighted to spend some time with him today. But he does some unusual things too. He's a showman as well. Now, I know, going back to the show of Hobby Lobby,
yeah,
I think that was on radio,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Yeah, that's radio. Yeah.
And they showcased you, what year was that?
Well, I think it was about 38.
1938?
About 38, I think.
And were you blowing bubbles in those days too?
Oh yes, I started in 31. That's about, I believe 31 is when I started blowing bubbles.
Well, you do all kinds of things here.
I should amend that. I was working with bubbles before that, but I'm talking about the first show I had, because I had several shows. I had them on various subjects, and so I thought, well, bubbles will make a show. So I blew about a 10-minute show, and with a little musical accompaniment, and it was for a teacher's party. And then I'd blow, have another show in about once a year, see, maybe.
Well, Eiffel, if I may interrupt you just for a second here, Bill is in the background there, and he's showing how you split the logs here, and he makes it look easy. He's a hard-working guy, and I know he's your son. He's going to join us a little bit later. He doesn't know that yet. But I'm sure anyone tuning in saying, did he say blowing bubbles? You're the first professional bubble blower I've ever met.
I never knew whether to call myself professional, because I haven't really made my living at it. but I've been doing it more or less for fun all these years. And, of course, that's one reason I've had so much fun.
Well, now, we're going to demonstrate this on tomorrow's show.
Yeah.
He's going to be with us again tomorrow. We're going to go inside and show you how to do that. But maybe you can describe it at this point. You encase people in bubbles.
That's right. Encase is the right word. I wouldn't say I put them in, but rather they're there and I pull up the bubble around them, see? And they're encased.
What prompted you to come up with something that people would enjoy as an entertainment feature involving bubbles of all things?
Oh, I always liked magic shows, and I think they're wonderful, and that's a beautiful art of make-believe, see? So something that is happening, something that's changing, see? Something that's alive, that's what I like, see?
Well, you're still performing. You're still doing your bubble show.
I like the element of surprise in a magic show.
Well, now, you also have a demonstration of lights that I understand is glorious.
Well, you'll have to see those. But I think they're wonderful. Again, something that's ever-changing, and yet it's beautiful to look at. I think it is, at least. It is to me.
Well, how do you describe your lights? How do you make them work?
Well, I just have to have lamps that whirl and are whirled by two variable-speed electric motors. In other words, they're trying to go two ways at the same time, and they go a resultant way, see?
You invented the concept. When did you do it first?
Well, I wouldn't say that I did it generically, but the whole idea was to so that it would show those ratios used in music, see? Music's based up of simple ratios, like the octave, 1 to 2, see? One vibration middle C, and then two vibrations above, see? 1 to 2. Well, if I make vibrations or impulses on the lamps in that ratio, why, they'll get something beautiful for the eye, see?
Mm-hmm.
So it's really a light machine. It's really a light organ, you might say. Only it's mathematical or geometric. All the designs are geometric designs, like squares, triangles, five-point star, six-point star, circles, ellipses, and spirals, and so forth.
When did you first come up with your light show? When did you put that machine together?
Well, I've been 40 years on it, odds and ends. Started out with just two lamps, and then I added two more. That was four. Then I added about two more that would go around and make a great circle. So that was about six. And so that's the way it worked out. Now, I'd like to have more. I only have six circuits of light, see? Six circuits, partly because of the size of my commutators, see? And I'd like to make a bigger and better machine. I think it could be done. But right now, I just show you the best I've got.
What does your wife say when you come up with these inventions and you say, now we're going to encase people in bubbles and we're going to have a light show and I need more circuits? Does she ever make a comment?
Well, I wouldn't say she. She always been good to go along with me. She assisted me for a good many years on the show. You see, 40 years ago, I was giving Chautauqua programs, and 40 years ago, at this time in October, I was giving programs over various states in Iowa, and...
You were on tour.
Oh, yeah,
you
I was on tour
Chautauqua
in the schools.
Circuit.
Well, this was school assemblies now, and then Chautauqua was in the summertime, but the school assemblies in the fall, and then again in the spring. Well, she was my assistant, and her sister played the piano.
Well, evidently she's very supportive of what you do.
Well, she is, only at first thought. She doesn't think it'll always work out.
Bill's going to join us after this commercial. He doesn't know yet. Yeah. We're going to get him over here after this word from Hooks and our other good friends. We've been joined now by Bill Plasterer, who is the son here, carrying on the tradition, along with Eiffel, and this is a very worthwhile life that you've chosen for you. You've chosen to stay on the farm.
Okay, well, I thank you for that. That I just appreciate very much the opportunity to be able to have to live in a country like ours and live in an area where you can do your own thing.
Well, obviously, you are going to carry on in your father's tradition right here on the same land.
splitting the logs, cutting the wood, doing the things that make you happy and feel fulfilled.
Well, we're fortunate too. This has been my grandfather's started to purchase a few acres here, and then gradually more until we've got 80 acres, which is a small farm today, of today. Mm-hmm. That we're also enjoying now by our dog here.
Mm-hmm. Well, now your youngsters and your wife, they tune into what you're doing. Do your youngsters ever look around and say, well, maybe I'd like to get down the street a little bit?
Well, hey, I've got four children away from home right now, and the thing is, they come back, and it's sort of amazing. I've got a son-in-law, bless his heart, he keeps coming to my wood pile and going through it, and it's amazing what they're doing in remodeling their house with slab wood on the inside, and it's beautiful. Everybody else pays big prices for it.
And he comes down. Some good wood. Check in on Dad and Granddad. Huh?
Right.
It's kind of good down, but there's good food around here too.
Yeah.
I know.
Yes.
Well, we admire your lifestyle, and we wanted to spend one day visiting with you and having you share with us. I know the national television shows, some of them have focused in on you too. Does it surprise you that people have discovered your dad and you and what you're doing here?
Well, it doesn't surprise me they found Dad, because he's a unique, very unique person, very interested. A mm-hmm. Person has to be interested in everything to be interesting. That's like you. You're an interesting man because you're interested
well,
in.
Thank you. That's very kind of you to say that.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, but I think this is a sad thing. So many times people lose their sight or their values. That I know we get to worshiping money too much, and it's an evil necessity. But that there's some interesting things here.
So today we've been sharing with you with Eiffel Plasterer and Bill Plasterer. Now tomorrow we're going to be right here, and Eiffel is going to be demonstrating how you encase someone in a bubble, and he'll be showing you his lights and doing quite a polished performance. I think you'll be captivated. Join us tomorrow. Have a good day.
You've been watching The Jim Gerard Show, brought to you in part by the pharmacists in green at your neighborhood Hook's Dependable Drugstore. Be sure to tune in tomorrow for another half hour live with Jim Gerard and his special guests. Welcome to the Jim Gerard Show, brought to you in part by the pharmacists in green at your neighborhood Hook's Dependable Drugstore. Now, let's join Jim and his special guests.
Today we continue with our show here on the Eiffel Plasterer Farm. He's truly an unusual man. At age 81, he continues to farm the land. And if you were to visit here, you would find any number of tractors and steam equipment, antique cars, barns full of these collector's items, which he has acquired down through the years, but that's only part of the story. He does a bubble show. He does a light show. You've been entertaining a lot of people for a lot of years.
Yep.
And also, he managed to teach school for 25 years, too, when he was a science teacher. You've done about anything you wanted to do and did it well.
Well, I don't know about that, but I've had a lot of fun doing it.
Now, today you're going to demonstrate your famous bubble show. Now, you've done these shows in various places. I know you've been on tour with this.
That's right. Well, 40 years ago, we were giving Chautauqua programs, so that gives you an idea of what we've been doing, and every year since, we've been blowing bubbles.
I know that Tom Snyder had him fly to New York, and he was the subject of one of Tom Snyder's shows, and some of the other big national shows have been peeking in on Eiffel as well. And today, Eleanor Ansley, our producer, has kindly volunteered to be encased in a bubble. Can you do that now?
Well, we'll try it.
Okay. You've never seen this before. Never before has someone made a big bubble. Go ahead, Eiffel. Go ahead and do your thing. He has devised a special solution here. You all set for this?
I'm ready.
This is a special solution that Eiffel Plasterer developed himself. And when he started doing this show years ago, it was necessary, of course, that you come up with a kind of a solution where the bubble would be big enough to encase someone. And yeah, there it is, right off the bat. Hooray, he did it right off with two tries. Are you all right?
Oh, that was great. Very refreshing.
Yeah. You made that look easy, and all he did was pour out his solution and kind of experiment a little bit and get it ready, and he was able to do it. And I know that people have been captivated by this. Now step over here, Eiffel. Let's talk about your show business career. Yesterday we talked about your farming, and we talked about your magnificent farm and all the things you collect here. But let's talk about your bubble show and doing this. Where all of you perform?
Well, we've performed from the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific, from the top of Michigan to Florida. And so we've gone, we haven't been in every state by any means. I always hoped I could be international on this, and now I find myself being international by way of television.
At age 81, you are being discovered by the television industry. That's not all bad, is it?
It's a great thrill of my life and a great thrill that you're here today in person.
We have enjoyed our visit so very much and captivated by your collection of steam equipment, the tractors. I see some antique cars. You have an eye for what is ultimately going to become valuable.
Well, it wasn't that. It's just that we liked them. And somebody says, well, what are you going to do with all this machinery? What are you ever going to do with it? Well, I said, now, look, I'm an antique. I'll be the first to be hauled off. I've saved these machines from the junk man so that children and young people can see these and realize that the people back there in the days 100 years ago or more were pretty intelligent too, because they gave us the basic principles. You see, even in an automobile engine, it's really a steam engine, because one of the products of combustion there is steam. Mm-hmm. And steam is pushing down the piston of the gas engine, whether it's in an automobile or diesel engine on a railroad or even a toy, a gas engine.
Well, your son Bill is a master mechanic, no question about it. I know he's rebuilt a lot of these things, and he was demonstrating as we took a tour around. He makes them all putt and hiss and do their thing.
Well, I couldn't do it without him, because he's very much of a genius as far as inventing goes, and I appreciate that.
Well, a little bit later on, we're going to take a look at your light show, and I know you have some other demonstrations to do with the bubbles and that kind of thing. Do you think just before, I can't do a commercial in a bubble, but maybe we can, I can't do it. I was going
to
have you encase me.
You want to try it?
Well, all right. I can jump in there, but I can't do the commercial. Let me do the commercial first, and then I'll jump in, okay? Hook's Dependable Drugs, my friends. Listen, nobody's going to encase you in a bubble at Hook's Dependable Drugs. If you want to be encased in a bubble, you have to stop in right outside of Huntington, and you will find the Plasterer Farm. And there, that's the only place where I know that there is a bubble act that you can enjoy. But you'll find everything else at your Hook Dependable Drugstore, especially if you want your prescription refilled or if you want some of the convenience items for which they're noted. Plenty of parking to the front and to the side, and plenty of people on the inside to serve you graciously and well. Hook's Dependable Drugs. You're not going to find big bubbles, but you'll find about everything else that you might need for your good health. Hook's Dependable Drugs, truly dedicated to your good health. And now, my bubble. We are enjoying our visit with Eiffel Plaster, a gentleman who at age 81 continues to do that which he enjoys. We are enjoying our visit with Eiffel Plaster, a gentleman who at age 81 continues to do that which he enjoys a great deal, farming his land, collecting various steam engines, tractors, automobiles, that kind of thing, and putting on his famous bubble show, which goes back many, many years. And he is demonstrating that right now. We showed you a big bubble earlier, and he's being assisted by Alice Jacobs, his daughter. I see now you're making the smaller ones. Can you explain what you're attempting to do here, sir? He's going to show us is what he's going to do. You take the bubble and you put it on the stand. And it's that simple. That
as we blow the bubbles of life, it's possible for two to blow them together. And so that's the way it is with bubbles, of course.
Well,
so Alice, my daughter, is blowing bubbles, and we'll blow two together now.
And there we are. One giant bubble blown by two, floating nicely in the air, and happily, I might say.
Here we have two bubbles. I'm going to talk to them a minute. Now, bubbles, you are two bubbles. I want you to become one. Now, by the count of ten, join. Come on, by the count of ten, join. One.
There it is, right on one. Oh, that's action, folks.
Now, all right, Alice, let's do that double one.
All right, this is a double one. A double bubble coming up. I've interviewed maybe 20, 30,000 people in my time. Never a bubble show. This is the very first bubble show. You're seeing it for the first time. And it's delightful, creative, unusual. When somebody says a bubble show, you don't expect a whole lot, maybe, but this is truly entertaining. And scientifically correct, because he invented it. And there go two together, floating together, and then over the horizon, happily falling on the floor, as a matter of fact. Now, Mr. Plaster, what's coming up next? Obviously...
The problem is, what kind of pipes do you use? And I like to show sometimes that you can use something that you have right around the kitchen. No problem about pipes. All you need to do is something to hold the bubble out and a place to blow in. So here, I'll try to show you that you can use a piece of paper for a pipe.
Now, this is a special solution that he has come up with himself, I'm sure. And he was telling us about this earlier. There you go. You can do it with the newspaper. If you have the right solution, you know what you're doing. How about that?
Just ordinary equipment that you can have. And the fact is, I forgot to get my water. Well, let's pretend there's water in here. I can have a glass of water, but since I don't have it in, we'll just pretend it's there. And I want to blow a bubble here if I can. So I take it like that, see? Bring it in like this. See? And you can put it right on top of water. Now, Alice, you show them your trick.
No,
okay. Oh, huh? Yeah, I'll take him this. This is going to take a little time. Do you want to get on this other side?
Alice, come on over here. We can chat a little bit. No. Evidently, you have assisted him down through the years with this.
Yeah. During the last 4 years, I've been assisting him. And some time ago, I did. My brother did it for about 25 years while I was away from home.
Well, he developed this, obviously, a bit at a time. Mm-hmm. I would guess that it was an inspiration from his teaching.
Yes, I can remember being in his chemistry class when he demonstrated surface tension and things like that with the soap bubble. He even demonstrated how you use hydrogen and oxygen gas together for water, and he used a soap bubble with it.
And that's how this show was born.
This is how it was born, yes. So we watched it grow, my brother and I. My brother, when he was just so high, was the first person he put in the bubble when he designed that particular trick. These are things that we use, like something like this around the house. And the kids like this type
flower
of thing.
Flower pot, yeah.
So I'll show you how this is done while he's doing that.
Now, this is just a plain old plastic flower pot with a hole in the bottom. And you can blow a bubble there, too. And there it is.
Yeah.
There it is.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes those will last 3 or 4 minutes when you sit them out. No fly hits them or no dust.
What's that gadget he's got over there?
The gadget he's got now is a special pipe that he's invented, where he can...
It's an old towel rack, isn't it, with a hose on it?
Not quite, but it looks a little bit like that. Then he floats this bubble in the air.
Oh, I see. Oh, he puts it... It's more ingenious than what I had thought.
His magic wand is what it is, wand.
Uh-huh. And so he blows the bubble first, and then he disengages the handle, and then the handle he points toward the bubble, and by blowing, now he'll get it up into the air. Oh, I got that. Look at that. And making your bubble float. Would you applaud, please, gentlemen, those of you in attendance here? I think you should.
And sometimes, if the currents aren't too strong, he can get it.
Oh, you may applaud again. Now, there's a closer for you. Eiffel, you are something else with this. You are really excellent. I can see why people were captivated. This is a gentleman who has done so many successful things in his lifetime, and always because he enjoyed it a great deal, which he shared with us yesterday. And he's preparing another trick. We'll show this one after this word from Hooks and our other good friends. Don't go away. Eiffel Plasterer continues to do his bubble show. Truly unique, something I'd never seen before. This is a gentleman who used to teach school, and he has been a farmer. And at age 81, he continues to do everything he's always wanted to do, that which has given him pleasure, and that which he was interested in. And as a science teacher, of course, with that kind of a background, that inspired his interest in bubbles. And he came up with a special solution, and he has bubbles doing all kinds of things. And he has been engaged on the Chautauqua circuit down through the years. He's been on tour. Now he's being seen on television. And probably his career now is greater than ever before. People are discovering what he is able to do and enjoying it with him. And just a while ago, we encased a person in a balloon. And now we have in a bubble. And they look like balloons to me. And the bubbles are now doing all kinds of things. When I'd heard about a bubble show, I said, a bubble show, you're kidding. And they said, no, a bubble show. This man does a bubble show, and indeed, he does do that.
Now, go down. It goes from side to side, see, like that. Down, and down, and down, and down, and up. Well,
and it
didn't cut it quite.
Yeah.
Not yeah. Forward. Foul, that's a foul one. Okay, we go another.
You got it. So, a refill now. Refill. We're going to do that one again. We're going to make the bubble go up and down.
Nice thing about bubbles, if one doesn't work, it doesn't cost much to get another. See? Up. Come on. Go up.
A magic bubble going uphill by itself and floating through the air. Oh, my. And landing right on the thing, too.
Yeah, okay.
You really did that one, I'll tell you. I don't know just where this is going, except that I'm just following him around, and I keep thinking that maybe he has done the whole thing here, but obviously there's more to come. What are we doing now?
How many minutes we've got? About four
we've
minutes?
We've got about three in here.
Okay. All right, Alice. We'll get my hose connected here.
He's got more gadgets for this. He's got a tank down here with, what's in there?
Hydrogen.
He's going to make you a little tree.
Going to make a tree mm-hmm. out of hydrogen-filled balloons.
Right.
Balloons. Bubbles. Bubbles. You faked me out. They look like balloons to me. Look at that. That looks like a snowman. A crystal clear snowman. You ever seen anything like that? Isn't that marvelous?
Christmas tree.
It's a Christmas tree? Well, it looks like a snowman to me, but he says it's a Christmas tree, and I'll take his word for it. It just became a Christmas tree. It's beautiful indeed.
Are you going to make it on the pedestal, please?
Well,
we're in a barn with a lot of combustibles.
It's all right.
There we go.
Now we'll work on.
We're going to do that again? Okay. All right, there goes the bubble.
Hydrogen is a lifting gas.
Hydrogen is
in the balloons.
And there
now
we go.
Now we'll do it on the pedestal.
Get on, one, ready, 1 second.
Okay, so quickies.
Get that.
Come on.
I'm scared.
We got it.
Okay, now.
coming down to the wire. And there we are.
Right.
And
right.
Now?
Yeah.
Ah.
No, okay.
Okay. Okay, here we go with the bubble. And this one here is a hydrogen-filled bubble. And another one down there.
What?
Woo, and that's the closer. Does that get your attention? We'll continue after this word from Hooks and all the good friends. They'll go away.
Yeah. Okay. Got it.
As I indicated yesterday and today as well, Eiffel Plasterer is a very talented man and a very versatile and accomplished gentleman. And at age 81, he continues to do marvelous things. And we're going to show you now his famous light show. I might tell you that we're not in a studio today at all. We are in his barn in the back of his house. And we're on his land. And this is what he does. And he collects here all kinds of tractors and steam equipment and ancient automobiles and assorted and very valuable old pieces.
You know, that's real nice of you, Jim, to say that.
It's true.
It's music to my ears. It's really lovely.
Well, you're a very modest man because, obviously, you have an eye for that which is important.
I'll leave that up to you. But anyhow, I'm very happy that you're here, and I'm glad that I can show this machine.
Well, now, you invented this machine. What is it, really?
Not the generic idea, necessarily, but I worked out ideas. Well, let's put it this way. There's music for the eyes as well as music for the ears. Now, the music for the ears is based on certain ratios of vibrations between the various parts of the instrument, like the piano, the various key, like middle C. It has a certain frequency, but octave above has twice the frequency. Therefore, you get a blend of tones that are pleasing to the ear. Now, if you take those same ratios, those simple ratios, like 1 to 2, or 2 to 3, or 3 to 4, these simple ratios produce beautiful sounds from a musical instrument. Well, if I get those ratios here, I'll have something beautiful for the eyes. So there's music to be seen as well as music to be heard. And, of course, that was music that I heard a minute ago from you.
Thank
you. So here
we
are. I've got 6 electric circuits, and there's 17 lamps. And I have to have 2 bulbs at least on each circuit. And then these 17 lamps are whirled by 2 variable speed electric motors. They can run both the same direction or one go in opposite direction. And you'll see that when we have them running in the same direction, we'll get spirals. When we get in the opposite direction, there'll be circles,
vertical,
but
circles.
I'm talking oblong circle. Now, what is it? Okay.
Ovals?
Ellipses?
Yeah. Ellipses? Yeah, you know what I mean.
That's it. That's what I'll show you.
Now, elliptical.
I'll show you a few simple designs that can be made, geometric designs like the five-pointed star. And I might say that when these designs are turbulent and moving, they're not in tune. But when the design stands still, then it's in tune.
I see.
Even
so
though the lights are going very rapidly, see? An incidentally interesting thing, I'm using automobile taillight bulbs because I can't think of anything that stands the speed better than that. I used to break 110-watt bulbs because they wouldn't stand the speed.
You could spend a couple of weeks around this farm, and every day would be an education. I have a feeling that we've only begun to scratch the surface here, but this is Eiffel's famous light machine, and we're going to demonstrate his light show now. And don't go away, because this is really spectacular. You've never seen anything quite like this.
Well, that's it. Now, I've got some lights, have I? Yeah, I guess I have.
Okay, fire away.
Well,
the lights
the
are not on. There comes the
okay.
Light.
2 circles. And we're going to make those 2 circles into 1 circle. Or into one, I should say, one single curve. It'd be better if I turned the motor on. And I guess we've got a 5-pointed star right to start with. And then a 6-pointed star.
Let's try it with four. See if we can get four circles. And we'll take the two out. And see if what happens here, if we can get them to make a single curve. A single curve. Now the two wheels are running the same direction. Now we'll run them in opposite directions. Two circles, and now we make one single curve. I'm trying to get a triangle. A triangle. A square. Now let's try combinations. Well, let me show you my favorite design. Just a minute, let me get this.
All right, okay. All right, we have to make just a slight adjustment here, and then we're going to see Eiffel Plasterer's famous design. Are we at the end already? Oh, my. Well, we'll just run this as time allows. We've been visiting with a grand man by the name of Eiffel Plasterer. He's got a magnificent farm right outside of Huntington. At age 81, he continues to enjoy life to the fullest and inspires just a lot of people around him.
You've been watching The Jim Gerard Show, brought to you in part by the pharmacists in green at your neighborhood Hook's Dependable Drugstore. Be sure to tune in tomorrow for another half hour live with Jim Gerard and his special guests.